everyone, my name is Abby Schmiedt, and I'm a software developer on the Blockly team. In this presentation, I'm going to be talking about the Blockly toolbox and some of our newer APIs. So I'm going to go over a little background information on the toolbox so you're aware of what features came out in what release. Then I'm going to talk about how you can define a toolbox, and the rest of the presentation is really going to focus on how you can customize your toolbox to work for your application. So in July 2019, we removed the Closure UI library from Blockly. The toolbox still used some of the components from that library, so we ended up just copying those components directly into Blockly core. This is one of the reasons we decided to rewrite the toolbox. In quarter two of 2020, we started rewriting the toolbox, and in quarter three, we released the rewritten toolbox and support for defining the toolbox in JSON. Most of this talk is going to be focused on the APIs that came out in that September 2020 release of Blockly. And finally, in November 2020, we released the continuous toolbox in Blockly samples, which relies on the new toolbox that came out in the September 2020 release. So now that we know when everything came out, we're going to talk about the different ways you can define a toolbox, and we are specifically going into more information on defining a toolbox using JSON. So there are two different kinds of toolboxes in Blockly. There's the flyout toolbox and the category toolbox. The flyout toolbox can hold blocks, buttons, and labels, and is really great if you only have a small set of blocks. The category toolbox allows you to break up a long list of blocks into different categories. You can define both of these toolboxes using XML. This is how toolboxes have always been defined in the past, so I'm going to gloss over this a bit. If you want more information on this, you can find it on our developer guide on the toolbox page, and I'll add a link to that at the end of this presentation. As of September 2020, you can also define a toolbox using JSON. So for both the flyout and category toolbox, you have a JSON object with a contents array. In the case of a flyout toolbox, the contents array is filled with blocks, buttons, and labels. In the case of a category toolbox, the contents array is filled with categories, and inside each category is another contents array, which is filled with blocks, buttons, and labels. So an important note for defining your toolbox using JSON, if you want to define a more complex block with something like shadow blocks, you will need to use block XML key and give it an XML string of the block you are trying to define. So due to time constraints when developing this, we did not add the ability to build a block directly from JSON. So what happens when you define block XML is that we take that string, convert it to XML, and then use that XML to create a block. It's this extra step of converting the string to XML that causes a performance hit when you open a category with approximately 100 blocks defined this way. So now that we understand how to define the toolbox, we're going to go into more detail about how you can customize your toolbox. So there are three main ways we expect someone to customize their toolbox. The first is by using CSS. Second is by overriding different methods on either the toolbox class or either of the toolbox category classes, or by using a custom toolbox item. So when redoing the toolbox, one of the main pain points people brought up was that there was not a great way for them to add a custom CSS class to their category. Users mainly wanted to be able to add different icons for each category, and this was often much more difficult than it should have been. So to remedy this, we added support for users to add their own CSS class to the category. In XML, this can be done by defining a CSS container attribute. In JSON, this can be done by creating a CSS config object with a container key and with the value of whatever class name that you want to add to your category. More information on this can be found on our toolbox documentation page under category CSS. The second way we expect someone to customize their toolbox is by creating their own toolbox or toolbox category class and then overriding any specific methods. Instead of going through every method on the toolbox and toolbox category class, I'm going to go over different methods that we overrode when writing the continuous toolbox and what that resulted in. So for those of you not familiar with the continuous toolbox is a custom toolbox with a single flyout that is always open. The user can click on the category to scroll to a section of blocks, or they can simply scroll through all the blocks that are in the flyout. This can be found in our Blockly samples as a plugin. So the first method we're going to look at is setSelected on the toolbox category class. So this method sets what the category looks like when it is selected. In the case of our default toolbox, we set the background color to the color of the category. In the case of the continuous toolbox, we set the background color to a darker shade of gray. The next method we're going to look at is addColour border on the toolbox category class. In the case of the default toolbox, this creates the border you see on the left-hand side of the category. In the case of the continuous toolbox, we actually didn't want that border, so we overrode addColour border and did nothing in this method. So the final method we're going to look at is the getClientRect method on the toolbox. In the previous two slides, we were looking at different methods on the toolbox category class, but here we are looking at a method that is actually on the toolbox class. This method calculates the delete area for the toolbox, and in the case of the continuous toolbox, we override this method and return the area of the toolbox plus the flyout. So this allows blocks to be deleted when dragged over the flyout as well as the toolbox. In the next section, we'll be talking about adding custom toolbox items. So to start, we're going to do a very quick demo showing how to add a simple label to the toolbox. If you would like to follow along, there's a link to a starter project on this slide. All right, so in this demo, we're going to be creating a custom toolbox item that adds a label to our toolbox. So there's two main files here that are important. The first one is index.js, and in this file, we're just doing all the setup for the Blockly workspace. And the most important part of this file is this toolbox definition here. So we're going to be modifying that later on. So now if you go over to custom toolbox item, in here we're going to create our custom toolbox item. And so we're just going to create a class. I'm going to name it custom label. And it's going to extend blockly.toolboxItem. All right. So now we're going to need to override the getDiv method. And in this method, we're just going to return a label element that we want to get added to the toolbox. So I'm going to create a label, document.createElement, label, and then I'm going to set the text on it. We're just going to set it to test1, and then I'm going to return that label. All right, and so that's really all we're going to do with that class. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to register this toolbox item. So we're going to call Blockly. .registry.register, and the first parameter we're going to give it is the type that we're going to register, so it's going to be a toolbox item type. So blockly.registry.type.toolboxItem. Alright, so the next thing we're going to give it is the name. So I'm just going to name this custom label, and we're going to be using that later on when we add this toolbox item to our toolbox definition. So the next thing we're going to give it is this class, so custom label. And the last value is true. So all true does is allow us to register another item with the name custom label. And this is just for demo purposes. Code Sandbox, the way it refreshes the page, this needs to be set to true. But in your own project, that might not be necessary. So now we're going to go to index.js. And in here, I'm just going to add that toolbox item that we just created. And so the kind I'm going to set to be custom label. So now you see on the right-hand side of the screen, test1 showed up in our toolbox, which is what we wanted. So now though, if we want to create another custom label with a different name, we don't really have a great way to do that. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna add a label here, and we're gonna give it a name test1. And now in custom toolbox item, we're going to use that value that I just set through the toolbox item definition. So I'm going to call this dot toolbox item def dot label. And so if you can see on the right hand side, that got updated to test1, but with a capital T. So if you go back to index.js, we're going to create multiple labels, and then we're going to change that label value. That's going to be test2. And so now we have different labels with different names. So that was just really basic how to create a custom toolbox item. So hopefully now you have a better understanding of how to create a toolbox item. There are a few different types of toolbox items that are supported. For items that don't need to be interacted with, you can simply extend the toolbox item class like we did in the demo. The best example of this in core is the toolbox separator. This is the line between the color and variable category that I have highlighted in red on this slide. The second kind of toolbox item is a selectable toolbox item. These are items that a user needs to be able to interact with. The toolbox will render these items, select them when a user is using the keyboard to navigate the toolbox, and call the onClick method on the item when the item has been clicked. You can create a selectable toolbox item by implementing the iSelectable toolbox item interface and returning true from the isSelectable method. If you want an example of a selectable toolbox item, you can look in the toolbox category class in core. The third kind of toolbox item is a collapsible toolbox item. These are items that hold other toolbox items. They do everything that a selectable toolbox item does, but will also collapse or expand when a user clicks on them or uses the left and right arrows. You can create a collapsible toolbox item by implementing the iCollapsible toolbox item interface and returning true from the isCollapsible method. For example of this in core, you can look at the collapsible toolbox category. For more information on customizing the toolbox, please visit the Blockly Toolbox Code Lab. For more information on defining a toolbox, please visit the developer guides. So thank you. Hopefully this helped you understand a little bit more about the newer toolbox APIs.